Okay. Here is the main physical processes, well known, which could generate the high energy emission. They are well known, the Bremsstrahlung, synchrotron radiation, Compton scattering, and electron-positron annihilation. And all of them could produce the polarized emission. As for Bremsstrahlung, it could be in the case if the electron beam is highly anisotropic, like for example, like a pencil. As synchrotron radiation, it is polarized with such a degree where P is the spectral index in the power presentation of the energy spectrum. If the magnetic field in which electron moved is ordered and regular, as well as so-called, not only synchrotron radiation could be polarized, as well as so-called curvation radiation. And in the case of Compton scattering also, it could be polarized component could be generated with polarization given by this formula, which depends on the scattering angle. And it is, will be, have the maximal value about 1 when this angle is about 90 degrees. And also in the case of anisotropic fluxes of electron and positrons, in the case of electron-positron annihilation, also polarization component could be generated. There are some other processes in which high energy emission could be produced, but they are more exotic and they have no such they are not so usually analyzed in processes when we considered the polarization. So this process we will not discuss in this presentation. And also I should note the very interesting effect which could be in the very strong magnetic field near the neutron stars and especially magnetars, so-called nonlinear electrodynamics effects in the vicinity of pulsar and magnetars. And it is a vacuum nonlinear electrodynamic effects, which could also, due to which the highly polarized radiation also could be produced. And the typical magnetic field value is well-known Schwinger field from quantum electrodynamics. Is such value could be achieved in some gamma ray pulsars, like a Corrab, for example, and in magnetars even higher. Thus, in such objects, the nonlinear electrodynamic effects also could be revealed as a highly polarized component in hard X-ray and gamma ray emission. And here is the list of objects and phenomena in hard emission of which polarization component could be observed. It is the binary system with black hole as a thermal disk emission, as coronal emission. Of course, already mentioned X-ray and gamma ray pulsars, neutron star cyclotron lines, neutron star vacuum biofringens, one of the non-linear electrodynamic effects, which I already mentioned before, magnetar X-rays, magnetar photon splitting, also non-linear electrodynamic effect, active galactic nuclei, blazar, and GRB jets, as well as different flares, solar and stellar. And now, we should emphasize that polarization measurements have no so wide, how to say, astrophysicists have no so wide experience like in spectral and temporal measurements due to lack of statistics, and that polarimeter, they are very complicated instruments, and polarimetric measurement is a very complicated technique. And to the present time, only a few experiments are known in which polarization of some astrophysical objects of high energy emission, in high energy emission, was measured. Thus, we think that it is very actual, as for a GHB study, as for a study other astrophysical objects, to measure polarization in X-ray and gamma ray emission. And among those objects, of course, binary black holes. First of all, well-known Signum X1 system, and even also eight experiment, well-known experiment, where the first significant polarization was measured in Signum X1 emission. In this, it is a soft X-ray range, polarization about several percent. And to the present, in this range, expected polarization for such a black hole system is at level several percent, and for hard X-rays, such more than 10%. But recently, with the use of well-known integral gamma ray observatory, a very high polarization component was measured in the soft gamma rays in this range, more than 75%. And here we could see it on this picture. It is the two-dimensional, three-dimensional diagrams, polarization fraction and polarization angle. Thus, you could see it is at the level near the 75%, a very high polarized component. And if we speak about black hole binary system, of course, polarization measurements give us unique information about the accretion disk structure, about the properties of the matter and the matter density in the vicinity of black hole, and of course, the reflected emission from the corona of accretion disk also give us information about the disk structure and the physical characteristic of the matter in the accretion disk. Yes.
I'm sorry, but I just would like to mention that for Cygnus X1, it may be that the jet presence.
Maybe. Best, yes. But also of this article from which this picture was taken, they not mentioned the jet. But maybe.
So
yes.
Okay. It's show presence.
Yes. Okay, it will be very interesting, because it is like an active galactic nuclei, which, about which I will speak later. And of course, magnetized, highly magnetized objects, such as magnetized neutron stars in pulsars and magnetars. And the most known of them are Crab Nebula and Pulsarinit. Also mentioned, also eight experiments give this polarization degree for Crab Nebula. And as I know, only this result is significant because we expect the results from Fermi, but as I know, they don't give, unfortunately, they don't give some significant data about the polarization fraction of gamma ray pulsars. But we think that there could be a significant just in pulsar emission due to, first of all, due to the synchrotron mechanism, because as I already said, synchrotron by itself give could give the highly polarized component, and due to high magnetic field, of course, we could expect that part of high energy emission from pulsars and magnetars could be polarized due to synchrotron mechanism and in synchrotron lines especially. And of course, here is the example of polarimetric measurements of crab pulsar, but I should note that it is a very high polarized fraction, but it is in visible light, not in X-rays. It is visible light, but in X-rays also about 7% polarized fraction is expected. But for me, maybe more interesting that in such objects could be observed nonlinear thermodynamic effects, about which I will speak later in details. It is an integral result, yes. But it is integral, but it is, as I understand, not integral because it is in visible light.
Because for integral, as I understood, off pulse.
Yes. 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 Yes.
But
yes.
In pulses itself, polarization almost zero.
Yes. 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 And of course, because why it is very actual and a great significance, because polarized fraction in pulsar give us information about magnetic field, about rotation axis, and help us to make an adequate model of such object. Yes.
Why is this anti-correlation between the flux and the
torus? Oh, I have no clear understanding.
This is very interesting result that off pulse.
Off pulse, yes.
Strongly polarized. Okay. Pulsed emission.
Not polarized. Not polarized, yes.
It's not polarized.
Yes. This is yes. Polarized by the.
Yes. It's not in the gap. It's somewhere just monotospheric effect. Close maybe to the light cylinder. But, teach me. Just measure and see.
As for me, I have no clear explanation. Why is it? And about active galactic nuclei, the coronal emission is expected to be polarized in the same way like a binary black hole system, because it's quite similar. But of course, the mass value is different. But principle is like the same object, and typical values expected some more than in the case of black hole, about 7%. But maybe more interesting in view of polarization is polarization from jet emission of active galactic nuclei, and because due to shocks they could compress matter and, how to say, make a higher magnetic field produced by shock, and then in this magnetic field also synchrotron radiation could be generated with a high polarization fraction, and this formula gives us the polarization degree. P is the, also the spectral index in power presentation, and one of the most prominent mechanism of generation of high energy emission in active galactic nucleus is so-called self synchrotron comptonization, and in the case of self synchrotron comptonization, such estimation of polarization could be done. And it gives the estimation of polarization degree about several dozens of percent. The maximal about 60, independence of spectral index from 60 up to even 80%. It's very high polarization. Yes, upper limit, of course. Upper, yes, 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 of course. No doubt, of course. It's upper, how to say, theoretical limit. They have no clear experimental data. And it is the result of modeling from these authors. They had a modeling for rather wide class of active galactic nucleus, for example, two kind of such objects, and here they give the estimation of polarization. This is the maximal upper limit, of course, and it is a different fraction due to self-synchron comptonization, hadron processes, pair creation, and so on, different kind. And we also see that it is the upper limit is about from 60 up to 80% independence of photon energy or frequency, and it is the area corresponded to X-rays, and it is the gamma ray, high energy gamma rays, in which blazars are quite observable. And this picture is how to say indicators for which experimenters should go and try to have some experimental data which could be put on here. Yes. And at least gamma ray burst. Of course, it is, as for us, maybe more interesting object. And as known, several years ago, from RKC observation, there was reported that in one GRB, very high, about, if I remember, 80% component was detected with about 80% polarization, but it was not proved by other groups. And now, as I understand, this result is under consideration because it is not undoubted result. But nevertheless, this result kicked on some theoretical, first of all, investigations in this branch, and also it gave for us, for experimentals, how to say, the purpose for which we should go and try to measure polarization component in GRBs. What we could expect in GRBs? No, here is the signal noise ratio, independence of energy for different spectral indexes. And we could see that range of so-called hard X-rays from about 10 keV up to about 100 keV is quite comfortable range for detection for observation of GRBs. And just in this range, we try to find polarization. Now here we could see the typical illustration of so-called GRB jet, in which polarization, in emission of which the polarization component could be observed. And there are several models of possibility of polarized emission which could be generated in GRB. Now we will discuss about prompt emission, first of all, then I will say a few words about afterglow. As about prompt emission, here maybe the same model like in jets of blazars. And the point is that due to relativistic, so-called relativistic aberration, we really see the small fraction of jet. And even in the jet, the magnetic field is not quite regular, could be toroidal shape. If really we see only small part due to this factor, where G is the Lorentz factor. For GRB jets, it is well known, it could be about 10 or even more. Thus, really we could see the small part of jet. And in this small part, the magnetic field could be quite regular. And thus, the fraction of emission could be polarized, highly polarized due to synchrotron mechanism. And it is also the result of theoretical estimation. The high limit of observable polarization is about also several dozens percent independence of spectral index. For typical spectral index, about 2, 3, as it could be seen from here, it is more than 60%. That is the same like for jets in active galactic nuclei. And if we take into account the anisotropic distribution of electrons in a relativistic fireball in jet, then the polarization could be modified to the more sophisticated model. And nevertheless, we also see here that in the wide energy range, expected polarization could be high and quite measurable. What about afterglow also? Here, the same situation due to relativistic aberration. We see the only part of the jet of such area. And if the jet evaluate and during each penetration through the interstellar medium, we could see different kinds of polarization, because the first stage where the observed area is small and there are no any polarization, then it will be became wider, and here this arrows show the possible direction of magnetic field, and it we could see here the domination of horizontal component, and polarization fraction will be increased. Then, because the part of the observed area will be outside the jet, polarization became negligible. And then, when the observed fraction became more wide than jet itself, it also became observable, but not horizontal, but vertical component. Such interesting interpretation, and it could be seen in expected polarization degree. Thus, it is, became higher, then fall down, and then once more grow and achieve the maximal value, and then also fall down. Thus, the maximal expected polarization in afterglow could be about 15%. And as I know, it was confirmed but by optical observation. By optical observations and polarization. Also, not only the synchrotron mechanism could give the high polarized fraction in GRB emission, but also so-called jitter radiation that could be produced due to magnetic field generated due to shocks in jet give additional fraction also with very high polarized component. Thus, the point is that try to measure polarization component in GRB emission is very interesting and is very actual for our understanding of jet mechanism, of nature of high energy photon production in GRBs, as for prompt emission, as for afterglow. Thus, we think that future emission intended for GRB study, of course, should include the polarimeter measurements. And now I would say some words about, for me, very interesting effects which could be observed near the very strong field objects, such as magnetars, first of all, where the so-called nonlinear electrodynamic effects could be observed. As it is well known, there are two kinds of generalization of Maxwell linear electrodynamics, so-called Born-Infeld generalization and Geisenberg-Eder generalization. And both of these generalizations could be joined in the general Lagrangian in such a form with different values of these coefficients. For Geisenberg-Eder, this value is such given here, and for Born-Infeld, they are equal and equal to this relation. And from this general, excuse me for such combination of words, general generalization of Maxwell electrodynamics, the dispersion equation in geometry optic approximation and for a weak flat electromagnetic wave in dipole neutron star magnetic field could be derived. And from this dispersion equation, several interesting principally observable effects could be derived. It is a so-called electromagnetic beam bending, Baer-Frenkens, and splitting. And bending angle was estimated. We estimated it for X-ray source near a neutron star placed. Excuse me.
This is a quantum mechanical.
Yes, quantum mechanical is Geisenberg-Eder generalization. Quantum mechanical, quantum electrodynamics, it is Geisenberg generalization.
Yeah.
And Born-Infeld generalization, I think, is not a contradict to quantum electrodynamics, but it is the other way.
I mean, there is H bar there.
Yeah.
So, if I understand correctly, it's like this polarization of the vacuum gives you like effective two. A refraction index, just a second.
Vacuum is like a nonlinear matter. It's the same effect like a Baer-Frenkens in material, but in vacuum due to very strong field. Very strong field play a role of matter.
So my question, so it's effectively you have your index of refraction is anisotropic. So it means that if you look at the images of a two polarization.
I will show the next slide, of course. It is a picture that we try to explain how it bending could take place for different kind of X-ray source in vicinity of neutron stars and put on the high distance from the neutron star. But of course, I understand you, the typical angles is very small, very small. And I think that the effect is very difficult to observe. You could see here the calculated, we calculated the angles, bending angles. It is the part of radian. And here also the part of radian in the source. Thus it is very negligible. And we have no chance, I hope, to see it. But not so bad for, it is such a very simple and evident formula, which give us the time interval between two modes of linear polarized signal component. One of them polarized, it is the time interval was calculated for simple situation when the neutron star rotation axis is normal to the magnetic dipole axis. This situation.
It's
yes. A few not degrees, a part of degrees. Yes, part in the source, but source is on a very far distance. As for me, I think it is very difficult. More realistic to observe the so-called biofringens, vacuum biofringens, because it is like a biofringens in the material. They have two modes, and if the Gewenberg-Eller generalization is valid, then we have a non-zero time delay. Or one mode relative to other mode, which are polarized in mutual normal planes. And from this, we could expect about 100% polarization in a pulse signal from the source near the highly magnetized neutron star. For example, it could be JRB from gamma ray repeater. Or maybe pulse from gamma ray pulsar, but it need a very precision and very difficult observation because we have some estimation for Krupp, for example, as the most bright pulsar, what we need in different energy ranges. What we need the instrument, and we need the instrument to try catch the effect, because only by epoch folded technique it could be catch, because we should fold the different pulses to make a and really I don't say, but really it's here, this delay is about a microsecond. It's a very short time, and thus we should measure during a very long time, about several months, for example, megasecond. We should measure with accuracy more higher than 1 microsecond.
Then better to increase effective area.
Yes. Yes, but it is need more very much money, because the higher the area, the higher the mass, the more, of course. As for example of GRB from soft gamma ray repeater, which principally could be, which front could be polarized, if it detect with resolution more higher than 1 microsecond.
If you just sketch up this gigantic.
Yes. Outburst. Yes. 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 Of course. Ah, but we need only 1 microsecond front.
Yeah, timing resolution.
Okay. Timing resolution. Yes. And what we have from what we have now? Значит, we have that polarization measurements have such problems. There are geometry effects. Due to electron beam, disk shape, and so on. It could be caused, or polarization could be caused by geometry object. The other kind polarization could be caused by physical effects, such as synchrotron emission in order magnetic field, which is polarized itself. And biofringens, about which I already said, it is also some physical effect, but it is a separate effect. And of course, it is necessary to separate them. How we could do it? Principally, it is possible. And the way is such, we should measure polarization degree and polarization angle in different energy bands, in X-rays, in gamma rays, and so on. The wider we have energy band, the more effective we could separate the different parts of polarization. And of course, fine timing, also good time resolution, which is especially need for example for biofringens effect. And it is predict some demands for future polarization instrument. Here you could see such demands. If I only emphasize on this point, that if we want to use the instrument for GRB observation, of course, such instrument should have a very wide field of view. That is evident. And what is the experimental technique? Well, here the well-known formulas about the Compton scattering, which is the basis of the most of polarimetry instruments. Well-known Kleene-Shinner-Tam cross-section, which gives the angular dependence of this cross-section, and well-known Compton formula for primary and secondary gamma quanta energy. In the case of Thomson scattering, this formula could be reduced to this one, and if we will use the so-called Thomson polarimeter with the passive scatterer, passive matter for scattering, the polarization degree could be measured from this formula, where here are the counts in different detectors which use in Thomson polarimeter. And the so-called Compton polarimeter is based on this relation. And one of the main value for Compton polarimeter is so-called minimal degree polarization, which could be estimated from this formula, where this value is efficiency. Of X of gamma ray detection. This is so-called modulation factor, which could be defined from here, where it is the maximal and minimal count from polarimeter. And it could be really calculated by substitution corresponding values in this relation, which was done, and thus the modulation factor and minimal degree of polarization could be estimated for a given kind of polarimeter. And here we could see the Compton scatter efficiency as function of energy for different kind of material, which could be used as detector. And we see that the band from 10 keV up to several MeV is quite appropriate for such measurements. And here the results of calculation of modulation factor and the function of polar scattering angle and photon energies. We could see also that in this range, modulation factor still significant. Is about half and 0.2. It is quite appropriate. And now several words about different kinds of instruments. Here I would present our Thomson polarimeter, which was used in our satellite Corona-C in the beginning on null years. How to say, it operated on the orbit from 2000 years up to 2005 years, 5.5 years. And it detects a very high polarization degree in one solar flare. At the very intensive solar flare in October 29 October. It is a simple Thomson polarimeter with passive scatterer beryllium and fixed detector on the side of scatterer. The other kind of such detector was proposed recently. It is the collimator from CZT walls and with a plastic insulator put inside. That's this insulator used for scattering, and photons scattered and detected by walls of this perimeter. The other way is use combination of two detectors, and one for scattering, one for detect of scattered photons. There are different kind of realization of such technique. This combination also the plastic insulator and insulator with high Z and high density, also plastic for scattering and high Z detector for detection of scattered gamma quanta. And also pixelized kind of such detector.
5 minutes.
Yes, yes. coming. Yes. So the parameters calculated for due to Bruce in this I will quick. And the principle of Compton polarimeter is the number of different detector placed to each other in such a way that scattered photon could be detected by pair of detector, like it shown here. No, such principle was in a well-known Archeffe experiment with the use of which, as you know, one GRB was detected with high polarization fraction. The alternative way is put two layer of detectors in such a way like in Compton instrument. Two pixelized detector, one for scattering, one for detection of scattered photons. It is the result of calculation of such detector. I will miss this slide because they all they simple show the parameters of such polarimeter and its possibility. And for more sophisticated measurements, we could use not two but several layers of pixelized detector. But as we think, the future is for multi-layer detectors, which could measure the track, and such not only polarimeter but space-sensitive detectors could be used for study polarization in very wide energy range, even up to several 10 MeV. Several MeV. And this is the principle of so-called Grom-S gamma colorimeter, now developed here for future experiments, which could principally allow us to reconstruct the trajectory of detected particle and quanta, and also to measure polarimetry fraction. And that is the other view of such colorimeter. And the other instrument which we elaborated now is so-called wide field gamma ray telescope or gamma scope. It is a combination of position sensitive detectors and coded mask. And its instrument also could be used for polarimetry measurements in two ways. First way is use detectors as all illustrated here. If we will use one of detector from a plastic insulator as scatterer, and both side detector from, for example, sodium iodide or lanthanum bromide insulator with a heavy insulator could be used for detection of scattered quanta. But as we think, the more effective way is to use classic Compton polarimeter with a number of different pixels, and it is the real picture of, from this position sensitive detector which will be used in this instrument. It is the view from the top point, it is a central position sensitive instrument, and five detectors from sides. And in this case, Yes, yes, that's just the last slide. And we will have here the coincidence of neighbor pixels. And if we will detect the polarized radiation, the neighbor pixel will be in coincidence, give us the asymmetry in counts. And the result of modeling of this instrument is the real configuration for 300 keV gamma quanta. It is a non-polarized emission, which gives the instrument, really it gives the instrument modulation factor or instrument non-anisotropy. You could see that it is at the level about at the level about 12%. But for 100% polarized emission, we have result for different plane, different orientation of polarization plane. And it is relatively unique. And we could see that it is about 50%. Remain from 100% for 300 keV, and it is for 1 MeV. This is about several dozen percent. And now we will work on optimization of this instrument for polarimetry measurements to optimize the sizes of pixels, the material, and we think that it will be quite effective for polarimetry measurements. Thank you.